Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Paladins European Champion Circuit. We're here in North America, in Atlanta, lovely Alpharetta,
right.
But we are casting the European side of the Champion Circuit and the Week 2, to be specific, to go ahead and see how these teams are going to face off against each other after the second week of competition, everyone kind of feeling their way in
that
first week.
That's right. So we do have a little YouTube video recap of kind of Week 1. What all happened here, but definitely this week is going to be kind of the ones to watch. We got a lot of these heavyweights kind of clashing this weekend here. First up is going to be District 69 versus Burrito here, and this is these are the heavyweights of Europe for sure.
They absolutely are. This is what everyone's been waiting to see. These teams weren't able to face off last week, Nick, so it's been extremely exciting for all of us, I think, stepping into today, waiting to see these two juggernauts battle it out. Of course, my name is Rain Day, and I am joined today by Hi-Rez Pretty Hair. You can follow us both on Twitter and, of course, engage in the giveaway we're doing today. Before we get things started, just want to let everyone know there's a chance to win a couple Founders Packs or some 800 Crystal Codes in case you're a Paladins fan. I'm sure you are watching this and you wanted some extra loot. That Founders Pack will give you access to all the champions forever and all the champions currently in the roster. So if you just feel like you want to play somebody and you don't have them, could be a great thing to go ahead and enter.
That's right. So like we said, our first matchup of the day will be District 69 here, and we do have that first map pick available for you, and this is going to be Timbermill. Timbermill is a map that we did not see once last week. It was banned out almost every single time alongside Ice Mines.
And the truth is, a lot of the teams spoke to us about that. It was because Knessa was so strong on that map.
That's right.
And so if you weren't able to get or guarantee that you were going to get Knessa, then it wasn't a good map for you. So it'll be really interesting to see the picks come out and what the teams chose and how they and who they prioritized.
For sure, for sure. So we do have that game up and ready and available to you. We're going to go ahead and get right on into it here. It is going to be on the left side here. That is District 69. Mm-hmm. And we do have a little bit of a spectator bug there, so that player name is not available. But it will be PERDO on the famous Androxus, gerrah on Cassie, eLvenpath on Buck, and Shipa on EB.
That's right. And on the side of Burrito, you're going to have SunCommander on Grok, Thiel on Makoa, LAizy on Knessa, Bird on Ying, and spunkki on Drogo. So right away, Nick, we automatically see the Knessa pick. And if we go back actually to the charts, it seems like that was the first pick that Burrito did. So their strategy was to go into this game, get Timbermill, and get Knessa first pick.
Yeah, so they are going to be rolling out here. We're going to ride alongside PERDO here. This is the one to watch right now. He's going to be headed up onto this high ground. No, he's going to skirt around the backside here. Nobody is on the point just yet. They are really focused on winning this fight first.
And he's already on the LAizy. That's the first blood for PERDO. He goes and takes down the sniper extraordinaire on the side of Burrito, but he gets hooked down to face the turtle. A reversal will save him a bit, but not too long. And the action goes down to eLvenpath, who's following up with the buck. He's got a heroic leap. He's trying to get inside the turtle shell, and Makoa hooks him back and says, want to get closer? Here's a little bit closer for you, and he takes him down. Thiel with two nice plays, two key clutch hooks onto the flankers.
eLvenpath a little bit overestimating his damage there, just went to elect for that first shot. Fire Brock has that progressive lead up, so you can elect to cancel that and just fire with one shell in the tank, but it was not enough, and he is taken down for it.
And see gerrah here on the Cassie on the left-hand side. Thiel again with the flank. This is unbelievable. The dredge anchor is doing so much work for them. Sheepa's just getting back into base on the Eevee, which is not the pick that we've been seeing quite a lot. And Bugzy on this Fernando, Nick, talk to me about this. Why do we see Bugzy, such a good Drogos player, such a good Knessa, on a Fernando right now?
Yeah, so he is going to have to pick one of the tanks. Everyone has to be able to fill these roles here, especially with that draft mode coming into play right now. It's important to pick up Fernando when he is available in this draft right now. But Makoa is showing that he is nearly just as strong as Fernando here, especially against this Eevee, against this Cassie. He is really good at locking them down.
And why is he so strong, Nick? You love Makoa. You've said
love
this for the longest time.
Yeah.
You are such a big fan of him. Why do you think he's so strong right now?
It's just the ability to lock down kills. Dredge Anchor is one of the most easily confirmed hard crowd controls in Paladins right now, and it is so valuable, especially with Eevees, those high mobility characters. Cassie's looking to roll and kite you around with that incitement card. There's just so much that Makoa brings to the table in terms of lockdown.
And he's doing really well with it. Again, he picks up eLvenpath, gets the headshot, but Thiel is just unstoppable. Bugzy with the charge, doesn't go exactly where he wants, but he does get the kill. And Jera's able to follow up a nice long-range attempt, but that will not get the kill. Shipa and gerrah clean up a few on the Cassie and the Eevee. And, of course, Shipa still going in with that mobility. Bird's illusional shatter there for his clones will get the damage, and Eevee's just disapparated as a result of that insane Ying burst, as this payload pushes really, really far through this choke point.
That's right, yeah. LAizy's been a little bit quiet on this Kanessa, and this was actually District 69's map pick, so they did allow for LAizy to be on that Kanessa, but they're just diving him relentlessly. We're seeing Perdo pick him up in the back line right now. Dragon Punch is going to come out and try and get, but Immortal is going to cancel that out. Nice ultimate from Bugzy on that Fernando.
And so Spunkki instead goes for Perdo, so he does get a kill with it, but it doesn't allow him to get the main target he wanted to get out of the fight, which is the Fernando. He's going to survive now. He's got the shield rotating around and trying to find some clean space to heal up. He does have Veteran, a crucial card in this meta, allowing you to get out as a huge tank and recover that 5,700 health pool and get right back into the fight. The Makoa with a really nice shield. He's going to charge away, though. The snipers are trying to find the damage, but they can't behind the shield. It's just too much. Spunkki and Perdo over on the upper ledge trying to contest against each other, and Spunky's forced to retreat from that fight as the push is almost at the precipice of being successful, but it's not quite there yet. They haven't mustered enough what they need.
Yeah, we're about to see a lull, or are we just coming out of the lull in the action right now? Spunkki and D69 have all returned now. They are all five. Thiel going to be able to pick up eLvenpath right now. Gerrah trying to find shots on the LAizy, but he's so low he's going to be poked out of this fight completely. District 69 forced to fall back once again.
And again, LAizy now seeming to, although we spoke about him earlier not finding his rhythm, seeming to somehow find a way to be impactful, forcing Gerrah to the back lines because of the damage. Even though Gerrah is on a 6th streak, he seems to be doing well. The Cassie really effective in this type of team composition, and especially at the long range kind of projectile pressure being applied to Kanessa.
Yeah, she's the closest thing to a sniper when Kanessa's already picked up. She has no damage fall off here, so you can see her just trying to find those long range shots up on the Bird, on the high ground. It's going to be good. He's going to find Bird. Perdo picks up LAizy. Double kill now for him. Spunkki goes down. Gerrah finds a double kill as well, rolling forward, trying to take out Theo, but the Angel Rage is available.
It's all about Cassie now. Can't she get the enough damage? The shield's going to come up and buy some more time. The Angel Rage from McCole is almost over, and he's going to turn back into a normal turtle. He does, and now Buck going to zone the teammates, but it's only Kanessa here. LAizy can't do enough.
No.
It's a rampage for Gerrah. He's looking for the kill, but he gets bursted down. Spunkki there, but Sheepa's in return. It looks like the fight's continuing. Perdo's coming along. No Androxus, a cursed arm, but he is going to have the damage. The reversal will take away some of Grok's potential to damage them, and the push is successful. Go ahead, do your thing, D69.
District 69 able to just barely hold on to the numbers advantage in that fight. eLvenpath on the brink of death there, Eevee, as well. Shipa just being able to stay alive, running that high sustain build. We're seeing the flicker come out. We're seeing that wormhole. We're seeing the reprieve there on all these characters. And now taking a look at some of the items here, it's all Havens on the side of District 69.
As well as on the side of Burrito. So Haven has just been a card that we've seen have such tremendous impact in this meta. What has been the results of that? What have people started to do with Haven and against it?
It comes down to your draft. You have to be able to split the damage here. You have to balance out your direct hit scan characters with those area damage blasters to force. So now there's only one blaster on each team, so it will be Spunkki on that Gyrogos and Shipa on that Eevee will have free reign. They will be completely unmitigated with their damage, so a lot of it rests on their shoulders to try and pull their weight, essentially, because they are not being counterbuilt right now.
Right, and that is the key, right? Because, of course, you can only counter certain things, and though cards may be very strong against certain objectives, maybe against the other objectives, they aren't as effective, and now we're seeing if the Makoa can be effective here as Spunkki goes into the Dragon's Flight. He's looking for a target. He has found one. It looks like Bugzy will go down, but Bugzy will also take down Spunkki as well, so a bit of poetry there.
That's right. I really like what Thiel's doing right now. He's preventing what happened last round. Everybody just came out of the gate just diving on Spunkki. Thiel is keeping a beat on eLvenpath right now, making sure to lock him down, making sure to keep LAizy safe. We know Kanessa is so strong on this map. It's just a matter of getting LAizy room to work.
And here's the solo ult as well by Eevee, looking to get rid of Thiel, who you said was just doing so much work in this corner protecting LAizy. And now it looks like Bugzy is on his tail as well.
Yeah.
He wants to find him, but Spunky's not letting him off without a chance at revenge. And there's eLvenpath. He's going to get taken down very low. LAizy sees the battle in his favor. eLvenpath's going to jump out. He's got his recovery potentially available. He is getting a little bit of health back, but the objective's already been captured. The time has been wasted, and that's just the icing on the cake, or should I say the cannonball on the buff man.
Some really, really good adjustments coming out of Burrito right now. They really just took a completely dominant. They dominated the entire area around the capture point. They're able to find it there. Thiel and SunCommander combining on the back line to really just shut down eLvenpath. They're really this pocket healer kind of bruisery tank strat is really, really working for Burrito right now.
Well, it's been so effective. Like, lately we've seen a lot of teams have this inability to have a mutable strategy, right, where it can adjust in-game. And we've seen just there the top-tier teams able to see something work and then all of a sudden see something not work and still make those quick adjustments the next round. So I love
what you just mentioned,
as we see Thiel just going ahead and peeling for his targets perfectly.
Yeah, so LAizy does fall down there, but it's able, Bird able to find the double kill with the Ying. The sustain is just barely enough, but all of his members of Burrito have now fallen. It is only Bird left alive right now on the scene. He will heal himself up to full, but he's going to have to wait for his teammates to return before he pushes forward.
And Bugzy here's trying to zone as well, but it's just so clear that whatever Burrito has done in an adjustment has worked clearly in this round. We'll see if the payload has the ability to be pushed now. They're grouping up on the top-hand side, trying to find it. There's a minute left, so there's not a lot of time, so they've got to make something happen soon, and it looks like the people making things happen is D69. They're trying to get all over Spunkki, and he is almost down. He's going to use his thrust to get up into the air, but eLvenpath takes him out. The range on that Bug shotgun midair is nuts, and that's going to be the kill for Bugzy as well.
That's right. Something I just, we haven't even mentioned this yet. I just realized it. District 69 don't have a healer.
Wow.
So
that's
it is the
true.
Double healer coming out right now from Burrito here with that Grok, with that Ying. What this allows Burrito to do is send SunCommander on this Grok around with Thiel on the Makoa and just be his pocket healer. And then Ying on Bird, or Bird on Ying, excuse me, has just free reign to keep the heal. He's got the raid heals. He's got the AoE.
Absolutely.
Just keeping his whole team topped up.
Absolutely. And it's so effective, right? Of course, you have to counter in that. A lot of people we've talked about have different ideas of how to counter the Ying deployables. And sometimes they go for the Bulldozer. Sometimes they go for Cauterize. Whether you're eliminating the chicken or the egg, it depends how you go about that. A lot of people have different strategies, and I don't think we've seen Bulldozer yet make it into the meta, but we may see that at some point if she continues to become as much of a problem and just output this tremendous healing.
That's right. So some great presence of mind right now. Here comes the Tempest from SunCommander to keep everyone topped up. Bugzy is a little bit separated from his team right now on Fernando. Thiel is going to chase this one out. He's going to miss that hook and just continue to chase this down onto the high ground right now. They need to be careful right now. This is in overtime, so Burrito cannot afford to lose any more fights.
And let's be real, the time to kill here, I thought it was low, but it's not. Bugzy's been alive for what feels like a year. He hasn't died in forever, and now he's got the perfect vantage point on the LAizy, and all of a sudden they forgot that he was back there. They thought he was gone. But Fernando never dies. That's right. Not yet, amigo. He's still in the back line. And what this is doing, Nick, is so beautiful because he's letting them know that they cannot keep their eyes forward. They have to look back, and he's got such a big health pool. If they all chase him, they leave the payload. It's
beautiful.
That's
absolutely right. Yeah, it's a really rough situation right there. Burrito in overtime cannot come off the payload to chase down this Fernando. They cannot go and confirm this kill on him. As a result, they have to leave him alive in the back line there because they have no other choice right now. The cauterizes, though, starting to come out in spades from District 69 here. Level 2 on gerrah, level 2 on eLvenpath, level 2 on Shipa. These healers are going to become less and less effective.
And as we talked about that, of course, the cauterize being such an effective tool, not only when you get it from 1 to 2, but when you go from cauterize 2 to cauterize 3, the impact is scary. It turns what is, you know, potentially a heal that can have some impact into you having to heal 10 times more to be able to have the same amount of impact. So it's extremely valuable if they're able to pick that up. So they're kind of just waiting and hoping that they can finish this game without the healers having too much of an impact until they get cauterized 3. D69 have taken the aggressive approach, and now Burrito are not better for it. They've been spaced out too far back. Shipa and Purdo already have the kill on the burn, and LAizy. Grok was there hanging out on the side, but he wasn't doing his job. The Bugzy Grok fight is going down, and it looks like SunCommander, who's usually an Androxus player, has picked up the totem, but that totem has let him down as Bugzy burns it down to the ground with that flame lance, and this is all D69.
Yeah, SunCommander getting a little isolated from his team there in that matchup. Fernando Grok is so heavily in Fernando's favor because when Grok drops the totem, he can't even body block. If Fernando is able to use that AoE Flame Lance to just cleave the totem down at the same time hitting Grok. Meanwhile, Bugzy has cauterized too, so the healing is not going to be that big of an issue for him anyway.
Absolutely. And so he's not really in that danger zone at this point. And now the Ying clone's getting targeted, but LAizy, he's the more important target. The wormhole will not come out. He just wanted to get to safety and apply a little bit of pressure, but he knows where LAizy is. So I'm curious what Shipa decides to do at this point. He knows they've got the capture point available. He's got to wait for his squad to be able to go. He's in the back line, but LAizy, because of the oppressor mines, he knows where he is. LAizy's looking for him. There's the blink. It's coming in. He wormholes back. LAizy knows he plays Eevee a ton.
246.
Yes! And LAizy gets the kill. He already knew what was coming. He had that sights, but it looks like gerrah has him in sights as well. As long as PERDO is around, LAizy is not safe. The two dynamic duos of damage, as we mentioned earlier, just going in and taking down the sniper from Burrito, and it is impossible for him to find any respite.
Glorious, glorious kills coming out there from LAizy. Here comes the ultimate from Ying. That's going to be a lot of AoE healing here. Ancient Rage also, but it is captured by Burrito. Burrito able to find themselves such a slight window and take advantage and keep themselves in this game.
The Ancient Rage was perfect to space them out. They did not want to deal with that Makoa. I mean, how strong is that, right? I mean, being able, one of the reasons Makoa's great, he's got the,
you never know.
He's got the greatest bait in the game.
You never know when that's coming out.
100 health into 10,000, yeah. Right? It's just nuts. It's just like, feels like nuts. It's
right.
A beautiful thing, though.
Yeah, so up on the high ground now is Spunkki, just keeping control of District 69, trying to get back on this payload. They have District 69 split right now, which could benefit or hurt. If they're able to find some picks, this is going to really benefit Burrito, but as soon as District 69 finds a pick, it's going to spell curtains for them.
Exactly. SunCommander here on the Grok as well. Grok seems to be a type of champion that some teams seem to favor, other teams seem to favor Pip. There really is kind of a mix between what supports your mentality as a unit. I think it's not necessarily a player. I think it's more what do we like in terms of the composition that we're putting together as a team. And Grok seems to fit in quite well so far, although being a little bit lackluster in my opinion.
Yeah. You know, looking back at my own analysis here, I'm actually thinking that District 69, their comp can operate split up pretty well. They got high mobility, Fernando. You know, whether or not that he's a tank, he does have good mobility. Eevee, nothing needs to be said there. Buck, really good jump. We're seeing that. Locked down a little bit by Makoa there, as a matter of fact. PERDO on Androxus, very mobile. Cassie, going to be able to rock and roll here with
that
incitement card. You know, this is a very mobile team. You know, splitting up isn't the worst thing for District 69, looking back.
No, not at all. And it seems like no matter what is going on, both of these teams keep finding themselves at an advantage and then a disadvantage, you know, depending on a couple of plays. And I think a lot of it is hinging on whether LAizy finds himself in a position to actually impact this game as he has been impacting. Look at that. The damage is nuts. The hits are coming out, and it looks like the headshots are rolling as well. LAizy trying to find him. He's looking for one more. Gerrah, he's able to get away. LAizy forced to recover under the safety of the room, and now he's looking for Eevee in the air. The Shipa goes down. This is nuts, man. This is nuts. He's looking for more. He's still on that roll. eLvenpath wants to shut him down, though, and Buck may have been his last stand. But wow, what a play by LAizy.
That was a huge team fight there. Spunkki able to find a kill with a Dragon Punch before going down. That's going to be Burrito's last fight, though. It took them that long to push. They will not have any extra time to regroup and try again, but they are keeping themselves in this game. It was unfortunate that they had to give up that cap and convert there to go down 2-0 early because they are really showing some signs of life.
I mean, this is just impressive what LAizy is doing continuously. Like, if you give him an inch, he takes a mile.
Yeah.
If you give him a mile, he wipes your whole team. And that is the problem, because no matter what, they have to deal with him. And the rounds that they do deal with him, they are successful. The rounds they don't deal with him, they aren't successful. Now it's 3-2. Next capture point could win for D69. And of course, it looks like cauterized threes have started to be picked up. Thiel, the only one, and gerrah on the side of D69 as well. So both teammates, they have one, but it's not spread across the entire group yet.
And a lot of these havens are coming online too. eLvenpath has Haven 3, now PERDO has Haven 3, and this is, you know, as good as LAizy is, there's nothing he can do against Haven 3.
And look at
Haven
what
3.
He's got, dude. Look at this.
Look at how far back he's playing.
Do you see
right
the card
now.
Though he's got?
I don't. Master, right? You know, we'll
you know I've taught. You know
bro,
I like my
whatever.
Master Riding, baby. It's all. It's so much is about positioning. Master Riding allows you to get to where you need to get quickly. And as a sniper, as a barrack, there are a lot of champions that actually really do benefit from this card, which is very much so out of the meta and it's kind of gotten forgotten about. But there it is, the damage from LAizy. He's able to have a huge impact now, and he's taking down PERDO. He's looking for one more. Gerrah's up on the top, trying to get the headshot. The headhunter is not available, though. His ultimate's charging at 70%, and now he's trying to find Gerrah. He peeks out, but he cannot be seen. Sniper looking for more kills. He's going to transport up to the top, see if he can find out the Cassie.
beautiful bunny hops right now coming out of LAizy right now. Those Haven 3s are online right now, but he's able to find the shot on the gerrah to take him out. Throws out an oppressor mine to slow down any would-be pursuers, and just beautiful bunny hops. What this is allowing LAizy to do is just carry charge around with him at all times.
It
feels like he is at 3 charge. 910 damage. He's still finding the shots. Somehow these Haven 3s aren't slowing LAizy down.
It can't slow him down if he keeps hitting headshots. That extra damage is enough. And there it is. Oh, my goodness gracious. The amount of time to even see that is less than I can imagine he has. I can't even imagine he's shooting this. He's controlling this champion, and I can barely see what he is doing. What a phenomenal play so far by LAizy, the god. We should start calling him the God Slayer. I think Androxus deserves that title if he can just kill LAizy. And there it is. Gerrah actually gets that one. Bird here, however, going to clean up
Gerrah.
And now SunCommander and Bird for the double kill. SunCommander cleaning up Bugzy. And there it is. It looks like eLvenpath the only one left. He's going to heroic leap away, trying to get out of danger as Burrito are able to start pushing this past the main choke.
Burrito just cannot keep their HP bars full right now with all these cauterizes online, despite having those two healers right now. Thiel getting very low. Going to have to pop that Ancient Rage. He couldn't get topped up in time. That's going to be forced out. Bird with 180 health right now. That cauterize, though, just too much. Bugzy on his butt with that flamethrower.
Absolutely. That flamethrower is so easy to apply the cauterize as well in an AoE fashion. It looks like Thiel will go down, and now LAizy is in trouble here. He's got the snipes, potentially. The shield will come up, and that will save him. Spunky's over there, but he's getting threatened by Shipa, so LAizy has a lot of people to deal with. He's going to wait till veteran, though. He tried for the kill.
That was
hot. He's going to wait till veteran and try and heal back up before he can get out to this fight. And Spunky's there, the masterful shot. Reset will stake place.
That's right. So Burrito right now just regrouping. They have the potential to take this first game, actually make this comeback a reality right now. 50 seconds here. They need to just find a pick. They are grouped up kind of as five right now. LAizy is returning to the fight. Nice long-range fireball coming out from Bugzy. But if they are not able to convert, obviously you cannot win off the defense. So District 69 and Burrito will come down to that Mexican standoff here, capturing the next point in the next round if this conversion does not go through.
And if it does, I don't know. Fernando, he's got a bit of an accent advantage in that standoff. So he may be the victor. We'll have to wait and see if it even gets that far. There's 26 seconds left, and the entire team of Burrito have grouped up. But again, here it goes, the headhunter, but that's
Bugzy
not going to allow him
line.
To shoot because Bugzy in the back line. He's going to have to defend himself, and he's going to go with the Immortal. A nice save away from Spunky's Dragon Punch. He's going to keep him alive for a moment, but not too long. LAizy is going to help with Thiel as well. And now SunCommander is pushing. The frontliners are there, and they're able to push this extremely well with Grok at full health. His totem is available in 3 seconds, and so this is what they need. A huge push is going to have to happen. eLvenpath jumps in, though. Here's the damage. Does he have the windup? Not enough, potentially. He's going to have to remove himself from this. It's Sheepa's ultimate that may end up causing the damage, and there it is. Bird, he's got his ult as well. Is he going to waste it, though? He's going to save it.
I like it.
Yeah, for the next round,
I like the call there. Yeah, so Burrito's team fight's starting to fall apart a little bit. It was unfortunate. Bugzy and Thiel there had to trade out. Both frontliners trading out at that stage of the game is very heavily in favor of District. Nice cheeky headshot there on the gerrah, and he gets the laugh. Gets the laugh coming out of LAizy. I'll see you, boy. But yeah, like I was saying there, the frontliners trading out there is very heavily in favor of the defending team there.
Sure.
As you saw, Bugzy was able to return to the fight much faster than Thiel was, and so they're very happy to take that trade, but it all comes down to this. Three to three.
Look at this. Spunkki picking up aggression. Buying aggression. Now, Nick, talk to me. Why do you think
This is good. This is actually, you know, despite, you know, my passwords on my stream to join my games are I will not buy aggression. Bugzy, it's okay for him to pick it up in this situation, kids, because no one has blast shields on District 69. So Spunkki is completely unmitigated right now on this Drogos. He is completely free and okay to be buying aggression. There is no chance for any of District 69 to buy into that blast shield that would mitigate it. So aggression is just pure damage right
and
now.
And to be honest, that's the logic, right? That is why, you know, I think it's the item you could say is in the game because it does allow you to build a heavier counter. And if you do get countered or have one team going too heavily on one type of defense, that aggression can actually do a lot of work on the player that doesn't. And look at that, the headshot coming in from LAizy. Androxus is trying to find it, but he is panicking because there's just too much pressure coming out. Bird is there, but D69 have a huge advantage right now. He's going to have to teleport away, but eLvenpath sees him, and he's now teleporting back into danger with Gerrah around. This is not the place he wants to be. Gerrah with the dodge roll. He's looking for one more shot on the Bird. Actually, it'll take two, and the healing, however, has kept him alive with eLvenpath potentially going down, trying to chase Spunkki.
Yeah, Shipa is going to be able to get up onto Bird. card. Here comes the Dragon's Fury, but it's shut down. eLvenpath going to kill Spunkki there. The whole time this team fight was going on, District 69 was keeping that capture rolling. Their team is so mobile, they're always able to have somebody on there. If they had to retreat out of the fight, get out of combat, and heal up, they can do so on the point and just get right back in. District 69, before that fight was even over, was 70 points in favor of that capture.
Yeah, and that was just the advantage of taking the more aggressive route with the sniper, having four members to be able to go and aggress onto the point rather than five. She has to be able to provide that type of ranged pressure,
right,
and she wasn't able to do that yet. She didn't find her early peek onto gerrah, who snuck out. She got one hit onto Androxus with the Perdo, but it wasn't able to finish him off, and she ended up getting killed at the end. That is, of course, LAizy on the Kanessa, and this was just a
good game.
Incredible game.
Right there. Looking at everyone able to do a lot of damage on District 69. Bird and SunCommander able to get good healing on the board there before getting too heavily shut down by these cauterizes.
Yeah, and just a ton of damage also coming out from both of the carries. We talked about the dynamic duo of damage. Cus and Stolzy on the NA side, but Perdo and gerrah have been working together for so long with this team, just doing what needs to be done. And 126,000 damage and 119,000 damage on both the Cassie and the Androxus is a very impressive feat. Above 40 eliminations, both of them. And you could say that the carries just carried the game. That is what they are there for. As impressive as LAizy's play was, it wasn't enough to outshine and outdo the effectiveness of what Androxus and Cassie were able to bring, and especially since Androxus could get everywhere Kanessa could get, right? If they Cassie, it would have been a different story if they only had Cassie, because she couldn't get up to those high ledges. But
there
Androxus
was so much pressure.
There was
I feel like, okay, so District 69 picked this map.
Right.
They picked Timbermill, you know, kind of probably knowing Kanessa's strength on the map, maybe baiting Burrito into picking Kanessa a little bit, and then they take Eevee, they take Buck, they take Androxus, all characters that can get up on this verticality and just pressure Kanessa out.
Right.
We saw first round it was Shipa and eLvenpath, you know, the second and third rounds it was PERDO pressuring out. It was just nowhere for LAizy to go. If he wasn't, you know, being protected on all sides by his team, he was just going to be flanked and spanked.
Yeah, and either, like you mentioned, either one of those champions could do a great job at flanking him. So the fact that they had three, he never knew where it was coming from.
Exactly.
And he
what
never
do you
knew
do?
What was going to happen. So his strategy had to always be different.
Yeah.
And that's very hard. It's just already taking his mental pressure. Talk about people having to worry about LAizy. LAizy had to worry about a lot of other champions in that game.
That's right now. So heading into the next game, we do have that map pick available for you guys. It will be Jaguar Falls. And just to go over kind of how these map drafts work, both teams will get an initial map pick, so District 69, they're able to pick Timbermill and sending it over to Burrito there. They pick Jaguar Falls, and from here on out in the series, it goes to loser's pick. So whoever loses this game will be the one that chooses the next map, and we do have that game available, so we'll go ahead and just get right on into it there. So on the left side of your spectator UI, it is going to be Burrito this time. LAizy going to be on Cassie, SunCommander on Fernando, Thiel on Makoa, Ying on Bird, and actually
Spunkki will be on Maldamba.
Snack.
The snaky snake. Perdo will be on Androxus on the side of D69, and Bugzy will follow suit with Drogo. Shipa on Eevee, eLvenpath on Buck, and gerrah on Victor. Now, they have no tank on the side of D69. This is absolutely
all in, boys.
All in. If they do not win the aggressive battle offensively, they will most likely have a hard time winning this game. I am really excited to see how this works, but I want to follow along with Maldamba, the brand new champion, because we haven't seen him yet, Nick, and we haven't seen him in this competitive sphere, let alone mostly just in-game. A lot of people haven't even played him yet.
That's right, so we'll be Spunkki riding out, and obviously with this tanky, healing-centric lineup, Burrito is going to take that positioning there on the point right now, staying grouped up, staying together. LAizy not wanting to get picked off this time. He's going to be on that Cassie Shipa, trying to get in on that Eevee and just pressure him out still, though.
So much damage as well coming out from the Maldamba. There it is,
atta
the first
boy.
Blood for Spunkki, and he's being protected so well with his teammates. He's going to get the kill potentially here. He's got one.
Snack.
He's waiting for the reload, but the snaky snake is not fast enough. Thiel on the side of Burrito is actually getting pressured out and taken down. So D69 with 24 capture points so far. And now, finally, Burrito has found a way. Actually, it looks like D69 at 40, so we must have switched sides here. they are already in a big advantage in this game. So it seems to be working out.
That's right. They're able to split them up a little bit there. Burrito not finding a pick, not getting what they wanted to go. Oh, but a nice dimensional link is going to keep Bird back on there. A beautiful fire spit from Bugzy to even initially knock him off there. But an even better heads up play from Bird to stay alive.
What a link, man. That was fantastic. Just a heads up play by Bird. And SunCommander, he's dropping the Ying illusions for him. There's a nice dredge anchor. Shipa with the ice block. Very good instinctively, however. But they do take down the Eevee. And now this is going to be hard. The death ball continues as the Ying clones get set up under the Makoa shield and the alternating Fernando shield. But it looks like Purdo is going to try and break that up in his own special way. And Shipa, he's getting back to base. This is going to be very important. But Burrito, they don't give him a chance to get back into this fight. After being picked, you've mentioned why Eevee being picked was so important. Talk to us why that was the key issue in that fight.
So getting picked right now, they need to get that advantage early. You know, D69 have a lot of firepower. They have no tanks, no dedicated healing. So if they're able to kind of snowball and get and take away the tanky or healing advantage that Burrito have with this comp just at base, it's going to be huge for Burrito to kind of snowball. This is a very, very snowballing comp for Burrito.
Absolutely. So we see the snowball potentially happening. Everything has to go perfectly for this strategy to actually work. They have a ton of DPS. You can't say that. And they may actually be picking up wreckers. They do pick up, however, a nice kill on the LAizy. A great barrage doing 2,800 damage and helping to finish that off, at least the 1,400 of it, so that Shipa could take the kill. And now SunCommander, he's trying to find his way there with the Fernando. We've seen that switch sides. No longer the Grok, but he's got the Flame Lance instead. But Shipa and gerrah are still doing work and are uncontested. That's the eLvenpath Buck ultimate, the freight train noise, saying it's time for business. He's looking for the kill. A really nice bounce off grenade there by gerrah as well. I love his technique on that.
Yeah, simple geometry here, knowing all his knowledge of the maps right now. Gerrah going to be poked out pretty low right now. Needs to be careful. Burrito doesn't have any hard dive right now. They don't have anyone to get to that backline and clean up these kills if they're able to escape to the backline. We're seeing just that as eLvenpath is able to clean up SunCommander with help from gerrah, who is just sitting there low health. Doesn't really need to worry about it because there's no one to dive him.
Right. And I love how on point this is. Why is this working, Nick? Because they are doing well in defending. Why is it just because they don't have that backline dive? They have a lot of frontline pressure and they can sustain, but they have no one to really pressure the Victor, pressure the Androxus, pressure the Buck?
It's a snowball, right? We saw Burrito lose that first fight here. Here comes
it's able to actually connect
there. The Sunday Wakona here connecting for Spunkki right now, but not getting a lot done off the back. Just hold that thought. LAizy picks up a kill. Thiel picks up one bird, and now the snowball is rolling once again for Burrito right now. They might be able to convert this.
Mending spirits onto the Cassie. LAizy is alive and well, and that's never a good sign. He picks up eLvenpath, and Thiel picks up Bugzy. It's going to be the conversion for Burrito. That's
2-0. Huge.
And
this
a huge amount of pressure has just shifted onto D69. If it does not work at this next capture point, it is going to be a long
This is what this comp is designed to do.
Uphill battle.
Right, so that is, like I said, this is what this comp for Burrito is designed to do. They are designed to kind of deathball and snowball, because as these cauterizes come online, as maybe some wreckers get online, Burrito's comp is going to start to fall off. These shields aren't going to hold for nearly as long. These heals aren't going to hit as hard to heal up Burrito, and things will slowly start to fall apart as we head towards the late game and right now. And that's why it was so huge that they were able to go up 2-0 in that first round.
Right.
They have to end it quick.
Exactly. As that late game becomes more of an issue, and of course the two healers get mitigated by cauterize, it is going to be extremely imperative for Burrito, finish things quickly before they get to that state. And now Maldamba trying to find this left corridor again like he did
nice
so
hook.
Well before. Really good hook.
Beautiful.
And that's going to take out Purdo right away. That's all they need. And now the snowball is alive and well. Bugzy, he's getting focused out, and he's going to actually stay alive, which is very impressive by Bugzy, and I think a huge point. It may allow him to get a kill. The snake is almost getting the kill. A killing spree by Spunkki, and now the guard comes down. The Mending Spirits and such a good immortal is going to allow actually heal to stay alive, as well as SunCommander. Sheep on the back end, though.
No,
trying to pick up the kill.
PERDO with that accursed arm finds two kills here, and this is what District 69 need to stop the snowball right now. Bird and Spunkki, the healers, the only ones alive fighting right now, but they are able to keep themselves alive. SunCommander on this. Fernando is getting lower and lower, but the shield is keeping him alive. LAizy finds the pick onto Shipa. Elvin's getting so low, gets hooked by Thiel and cleaned up. LAizy on a double kill right now, looking for more.
And now it looks like Maldamba
has found himself in a really nice and cozy place, enough to even press B for BM and get the emote going. And now Bugzy, he's here. And he wants some kills.
Oh, nice double tap. So you mentioned B for BM, but I was actually talking with some of the players. They actually do this when they're on the – obviously there is BM scenarios, but when they're on the point, B, it puts you in third person. So they actually use that as an opportunity to quickly scan the area in third person.
Very interesting. That is
tactical BM.
Tactical BM. That is the great approach there, as well as
aggressive
giving you – it's two killing two birds with one stone. You're taunting your enemy, and you're getting – a little bit of extra vision, which everybody loves. So here's the defense happening. It's really going to be in the hands, I think, of Purdo to go ahead and get some of these targets. But Thiel is just focusing him so well with the dredge anchor. You saw him get out in that early fight. The first kill went to Thiel and squad against Purdo. And it just seems like he's going to need to be the one to step up with that Androxus, hit some big Accursed Arms, take down Bird, and Spunkki, who's just been unkillable.
Sitting dug. There are good targets for his Accursed Arm. eLvenpath, though, stepping up huge in that last fight on the buck here. We're seeing the aggression start to come out as Burrito has respawned and returned. LAizy's going to be taken down by eLvenpath. I'm loving seeing this pick coming out of him again, and Perdo's going to be cleaned up off the back of a nice dredge anchor.
And again, Bird on a 10 streak, right? We see Bird on a 10 streak, Thiel on a 4 streak. It's just so hard for Bugzy and Squad to actually
Ying's
finish the kills onto Ying and the Spunkki because they have so much.
The clone gets
hit by the dragon punch.
Was that intentional?
And
I don't even know.
Completely immunes himself from any damage for any other player, and he just wastes a one-hit KO onto a deployable.
I don't know if Bird did that on purpose or not, but that was an absolutely godlike play. If he did there from Bird, I'm just going to go ahead and give him credit and say that was intentional here. Burrito looking to close things out, though. It's inching closer and closer. eLvenpath, the only one left alive to contest this. He's going to go down, and Burrito going to close out early. Exactly what they wanted with this
call. Wow. What a play.
Off the back, dude. Oh.
I think that Dragon Punch play just goes ahead and summarizes what this game was, right? The attempt at a Dragon Punch, and you accidentally hit a Ying clone. That's...
That's it, dude.
That's just not where you want
to go. I hope that was intentional. God,
I
hope
that
was intentional.
You don't want that on your resume. I dragon punched a Ying clone. You don't want that.
Awkward.
Exactly. Yeah. You have to let a little silence come in. But no, that was a fantastic play, though, on the side of Burrito. All just aside, they came with a strategy, and as well as D69, they had a strategy to counter that. Like we saw in the earlier game, D69 kind of baited out the Knessa pick and had a really good strategy to counter that. They wanted to do that here with the shields, but they ended up having to focus on the healing so much, and they weren't able to get value for it. So the dives that they were taking onto LAizy, those would work. But Spunkki and Bird stayed alive only with one and two deaths out of the entire game. And that was what was really so incredibly unfortunate about their composition, was because it's so critical that they do get those kills when they make those dives. For instance, if Bird goes down or Spunkki goes down, that's a completely different scenario.
Sure.
Fernando loses his support, Mako loses his support, and of course you have 130,000 healing on the side of both of them.
Yeah, Bird and Spunkki, not under a lot of pressure, like you mentioned here. One death on Spunkki, two deaths on Bird. Obviously some really good play from Bird to stay alive that one time when he links back up onto the platform here. But yeah, this is the snowball comp. This is exactly the kind of things you expect to see right now, these stats. A lot of healing. A lot of damage coming out from Burrito early and just keeping District 69 on the back foot the whole time, getting it done.
And do you think that this is going to be the continued strategy? D69, they kind of seem like, I don't want to say hard-headed in a negative way, but it seems like when they think something is the right way to be done, they're going to keep on doing it. And so I think that these baited strategies, I would not be surprised if they tried this again on a different map.
Yeah. Well, that was Burrito's map pick, so going into this, this will be District 69's map pick, so maybe this is something Burrito been practicing, something they know kind of works on Jaguar Falls. It's going to kind of come down to the map pick, you're right, to see if this sort of snowball-y comp is going to continue to work, if they want to risk running it again, because this is risky, like we mentioned.
This
comp falls off hard once they get cauterizes, wreckers, that sort of thing online right now. District 69 doesn't have the time to do that. It was a 9-minute and 19-second game.
I mean, that's what you're looking at, the damage, and the damage is completely astronomically in favor of D69. D69's damage was nuts in comparison, and if you just continue to add havens, blast shields, and you add cauterizes, that's only going to be a huge discrepancy that's built even further.
That's right. So we're going to head over to the map screen now. It will be Frozen Guard, actually. District 69 elect
What do you feel about this map?
I'm okay with it. I like it. Obviously, the reason Ice Mines is banned out 90% of the time is because the respawn, what's the word I'm looking for? The length, the distance between where you respawn and where you need to get to the payload is so colossal on Ice Mines that it almost makes it impossible to push through and convert, so you're almost always placed in that 3-3 scenario.
Yeah.
Which is why teams don't like to play on that, because you're not able to do things like the snowbally comp and try and end things early.
Exactly, right. That push just gives the defending team too much time. And, of course, as we transition into the next game, it looks like we're going to see one of my favorite champions step into the realm for battle on the side of D69, and that is going to be Bomb King. And we're also going to see Knessa coming out as well onto Bugzy. So this will be really great. Bugzy is one of the very premier Knessas, especially in Europe, against LAizy's, almost right there. Potentially better. He'll have to showcase his skills here for all of us to see. But he's going to be on Knessa. Gerrah will be on Cassie. Shipa on Eevee. PERDO on Androxus. And eLvenpath on Bomb King. So again, no tanks. I knew it. They were going to go with this again.
Yeah, so they're coming out. Guns swinging this time. SunCommander is going to be on Ying. LAizy on Fernando. That's weird to say. Thiel going to be on Makoa. Spunkki on Drogos. And Bird on Barrick.
And there's the pull already, and this is already a fantastic start for Thiel. They've got the point pressure, they know that, but they're trying to out-damage them from the distance, and then once that damage output becomes too much, move in for the kill. There's a blink coming in from Shipa. His play is going to be completely important here, but they've got the pressure from Grumpy Bomb now to space out and kind of isolate some of the targets. And it looks like Gerrah, he could fall. No one has died yet. This is a beautiful position for everyone to be in. D69 have no healers, so they cannot sustain the same way that their counterparts on Burrito can, with Ying as well as just...
Look at the capture, dude.
The Barrick. I mean, it's just so hard.
No one's died yet, and Burrito are 80, 90 points in capture advantage. First blood finally going in 1:40. Bird going to go down to eLvenpath, but Burrito need one more point. It's in overtime right now. They're losing this fight, but they are in such a good position to capture this one up, heal up, and come back, win one more fight. Spunkki with a double kill is going to shut this down immediately. Burrito going to capture and go up 1-0.
But you do see that, though. The plan that they're working for, Shipa and everyone, Shipa stayed alive that entire fight, and he wasn't able to land some really crucial blink, huge critical damage shots. But if they were to have connected that, the snowball was starting to get there. They were almost fully wiped.
Yeah.
And if you would have connected with the Drogos, it would have been, I think, a different story, and then their zoning potential would have been just too strong. So this is almost working for them.
Yeah, it's fine. District 69 are going to lose these first couple of fights with this just comp disadvantage. But as we head into the late game, every second that ticks off the clock is going to be pushing things in favor of District 69. PERDO picks up a double kill. LAizy finds eLvenpath in the back. SunCommander picks up PERDO as well. And things are looking good for Burrito.
Barrick. Barrick is doing a lot for this team right now. Talk about Barrick's role. And obviously, no Maldamba. They decided to go with Barrick here. What's his role? What is he doing for this team? And why did he get picked up?
Barrick is more of like a win more character.
Okay.
If you're able to get set up, obviously, with that Makoa shell shield, with that Fernando shield, you're able to get Barrick in there, get him set up, and that is really all you need for Barrick to be effective.
And this is a very tough spot for them to be in, especially with Bugzy having to contest the payload. They're going to lose their sniper.
Ying in the grass.
And although Sheepa's going to come down, it's a nice ultimate. They need someone to contest, and it's not going to be enough. And that, unfortunately, is an ult wasted. I know that, to me, says that they were desperate to basically win and pause that because they didn't want to go down 2-0. Otherwise, Sheepa would have said, it's okay, 2-0. We know this. We're waiting for the end game. Let's save my ult for that next fight.
I just thought about this. Burrito have Drogos. They have these tank counters. District 69 really could use that Dragon Punch right about now here. It is going to be available for Spunkki. Head out into this fight, but we're seeing the cauterizer starting to come through. We got two wreckers online, one for Gerrah, one for Bomb King here. Like we mentioned, the ball is in Burrito's court to close this out early because District 69 are going to start winning these fights as the game progresses.
And I think it's really going to be up to a huge King Bomb right here. With eLvenpath, his ability to pressure the point with Grumpy Bomb, he's running Countdown, he's running Doomsday, so he's going to have the ability to do more damage to Shield. But the early pick from Thiel has been what has caused everyone to have a big issue. They're going to force him off the point now. Barrick will not be able to stand here. He's dead.
Rip.
Barrick is gone. See ya, Bird. And now it looks like Spunkki could be done as well. That's a double kill. That, is all they were looking for, and we have to see now how this comp works out, because this is what D69 were praying. They were hoping for. They were living on a prayer for. This is where Bon Jovi comes in. You get that song, because this is the exact moment they want. The zoning pressure now is going to be very, very strong from D69, but they don't want to leave the point yet because they want to capture as much as possible. So if they do have to retake it, they're already in a good position.
That's right here. LAizy is going to be leading the charge right now. Here comes the Dragon Punch, and Thiel going to find the Dredge Anchor. eLvenpath solo, but he's not able to find the shots onto Thiel. Ancient Rage going to be forced out right now. He's going to be cleaned up.
Baited, and there's PERDO. He's got to get out of here. He's got the reversal,
nice.
But the
Yo.
Dredge Anchor is going to take him down as well. This is just so good on the side of Thiel, and again, that was why they were not able to get the victory early on in this first contest. It's because Thiel was putting so much pressure on them.
It's ult for ult, right? So District 69 came in hot with their ultimates, but Burrito's got ults too. They know how to use them. They use everything there to its fullest potential right now. LAizy just shutting down this corridor entirely, literally closing it off with his shield right now. Burrito able to come back using that heavy capture advantage they gained in that first fight before they lost it.
Yeah.
Were able to quickly shut this one out and go up 3-0.
And we don't see LAizy on characters like Fernando very often.
He's killing himself. He's killing Kanessa.
Himself, right?
This is weird, dude.
Looking in the mirror and
LAizy on Fernando killing a Kanessa in the back line.
This is a little,
I guess, you know, you mentioned
traumatizing.
You mentioned how he's so good at Eevee. This is one of the other main characters that he plays there. He was able to read Shippa's movements on Timbermill in the first map and just be so effective against it. He knows inside and out the characters that he plays, and so he's able to counter them as a result.
But then there's the Fernando as well, just knowing exactly how weak, right, the Kanessa is and how effective a Fernando when he gets up close to a Kanessa he can be, because she just has no ability once she's used that transporter to get away from him.
That's
and now
right.
The snipes are coming out from Bugzy. He's been one that's been a little quiet. He's on a 3-streak. We haven't noticed his impact as much as we would have expected.
This map, this comp, it's tough. Bugzy found a double kill there. He didn't go down too LAizy in the back line. They were able to find a couple of clutch kills, but it's so tough right now. Look at this pressure. Like, Kanessa's not super great with tanks in her face, man.
No.
It's just not how the character works.
No, and that's true. And now, because they're forced to defend, she's got to set up in these very isolated choke points. It's not quite available yet, but eLvenpath and this Bomb King, I haven't seen it be as effective as he wanted.
That King Bomb was good.
The King Bomb was fantastic, but that's all we've kind of seen from it. And it feels like Bomb King was picked as a great Accursed Arm comes up for PERDO. He takes down the Barrack, and that's actually a really big pick for them because they're by their base. So if they could stay alive here, this is a really, really good trade. Yeah.
Yeah, but they're inching closer and closer. eLvenpath right now going to be hooked out on the point. Shipa trying to get in there and do what he can, but these heals are just so much. Here comes the Shell Shield. Dragon Punch as well to help close things out. LAizy and the boys of Burrito just have everything available to them. The Immortal as well. They are looking to close it out, and they do 4-0 again for Burrito running the same comp.
Well,
sheesh.
I can't say.
Can't say we didn't warn you.
I wasn't. Yeah, exactly. I can't say I didn't warn you. I said when D69 likes to do something, they tend to get it in their head that that's the way to do it.
Yeah.
And as much as I was complimenting both teams for being mutable earlier on and having the ability to transition their play styles depending on what was working and being flexible, I haven't seen that here. And although they tried this comp against the super tank death ball, it seems like the tank death ball is the safer pick. This is often why in professional games and professional circuits, we see pro players take the safe route. Yes, gerrah, Bugzy, Shipa, PERDO, eLvenpath. This comp could have won. If they got the right picks, if they got the early picks, it would have been fantastic. But was it the safest play? Absolutely not. And that's where they veer off. That's part of the reason why they're great.
I'd be surprised if they didn't switch it up this time. They got to do something.
It's do or die now. So at the end of the day, whether you believe something works or not, you've seen two testaments to why it doesn't, and that is, I believe, what is going to result in hopefully a switch. I mean, personally, I would switch. I have no idea what they're going to do, but that's my call. That's
kind of something.
Exactly. That's kind of where I would go with this. I would take a different approach. To me, one of the biggest problems they've had is the Ying. I would try to get the Ying on the side of D69. I find that whatever they're doing, she is being that kind of thorn in their side. Two deaths. Only. Every single time, she has not been able to be killed or dealt with by this aggressive lineup, and it's just too much invested and not enough return to try and kill her.
Yeah, it's a lot of healing coming out from that Ying, especially when you're not able to get her cauterized. She's that much better in these snowbally comps where the games are ending in 9 minutes.
Right.
Cauterized one is just not super effective against Ying's just colossal healing output.
She had 55,000 healing in nine minutes.
That time includes the draft phase, too. So this is more like an 8-minute game.
I mean, that's nuts. Yeah. That, to me, is enough to say the Ying has been the problem. That's what I've seen. So we'll see.
Ying was the problem.
Yeah, so we'll see what ends up happening as we bring up the next map screen as to what they'll be going with.
Yeah, so, of course, District 69 did lose that game. So Burrito is up 2-0 in the series right now. So Serpent Beach is going to be District 69's map peak. This is a map very well liked by the teams, very well practiced by the teams. They know how these comps are going to function. They know the ins and outs of this map. They've had many times to just practice and get things going. So we'll have to see what comp switch, if any, that District 69 elects to make.
And as we load into the game, let's follow along with D69 and get the lineups here. PERDO is on Androxus. Gerrah is on Cassie. Shipa will be on Grok. Bugzy on the Eevee. And eLvenpath will be on Fernando. So they have taken the Grok. Yep. They've gone with the healing. They've gone off of this. So it seems like they've made the adjustment, Nick. And now on the side of Burrito.
Yeah, Merrick going to be played by Bird. LAizy going to be on Maldamba there. LAizy running the gauntlet here today with his champion select. Yeah, spunkki going to be on Drogos. Thiel on Makoa there. And then we don't quite know because of that spectator bug. So it will be
Spunkki, I believe. Should be Spunkki. Oh, no, it's Ying. Not Spunkki. Yes. That is Bird. Oh, no, that's not Bird.
Five.
We'll have to go around. There's so many things to keep track of. SunCommander, that's who it is on the Ying. And,
I haven't seen him on Androxus today at all.
Yeah, no, it seems like he switched up to a more.
I like
that
Burrito's drafting has been really good for me today.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. I want to see how they deal with this Ying, first of all. That's really what I want to see. The Ying has been prioritized, and all of a sudden, eLvenpath, too aggressive. He gets taken down to half life, but here's PERDO onto the Ying. But again, she's able to illusion and get away only so much, and that's exactly what I want to see. The first blood coming out onto the Ying, but LAizy has his sights onto the Androxus. PERDO is almost getting away, and now Bird, he's on the point battling at the clock, but Shipa and eLvenpath together are too much. They're going to force Bird off the point, and LAizy is having to get away. He's got the extra movement distance on the Slither, which is very important, and he's also got the healing from Mending Spirit, so he's going to stay alive. But it's not going to help his team right now because he's not able to get onto the point.
LAizy going to be pushing up with the boys right now. A little bit knocked off the map is PERDO. LAizy going to follow to that aggression off the map. Now being pressured out by Thiel. He's getting very low. eLvenpath is here backing him up too. And Thiel's going to drop.
Double kill by PERDO. And a nice defiance as well. Don't often see the right click from Androxus very often. But if you do hit all three of those shots, you do see the big payoff there. It's kind of the risk of reward. He's going for SunCommander. I love it. The kill on the Ying. He says, get out of town. You want some of this Yang? I'll give you that, Ying. If you need some more, I'm here for you. And there's PERDO targeting the Ying again. SunCommander goes down. He can't defend himself as well as normal because he's not on that Androxus, which he's so well known for. But Thiel, he decides to end PERDO. If PERDO has a chance, he didn't take it, and that is all that he wrote. So that's going to be the end for that. But Ying getting totally targeted.
It's a good adjustment for District 69. We talked about in game two, the healers not really feeling the heat there. The Maldamba had one death. Bird on Ying had two deaths there, and now Ying's starting to feel the sting of the God Slayer in her side.
She absolutely is, and it is a deadly sting as well. Thiel and LAizy and Bird now in a good spot because they can use the Ying clone to keep healing them up, and she's very safe. So this is one of those initial choke points, Nick, that is kind of difficult to get past, especially with a more of a tanky team.
Definitely here. Burrito able to stabilize very nice, but who's that creeping in the back line? It's Bugzy there on the Eevee, ever-present. Oh, but a nicely timed rocket from Spunkki. We'll take him down as soon as she comes out of that ice block. Eevee feeling that nerf.
And Eevee is also not able to do as many of the things she was offensively, let alone defensively. It's a bit of a cripple on both sides of the game. And so maybe that's why Shipa wasn't able to be as effective in their offensive strategy as he wanted to as well. That nerf not allowing Eevee to blink when she is in ice block. It was implemented about a patch ago. So players still getting used to it. Some players dropping her. And then some players still keeping up. EU seems to like Eevee.
Yeah, EU favoring Eevee a little bit more than NA right now. But like you mentioned, look at this choke, dude. This is going to be really hard for District 69 to break. Two Ying clones, two turrets, Thiel. Going to be pop forced into that Ancient Rage. This is what they need if they want to break this choke. They need Thiel to go down here. They need that tanky frontliner to shatter.
Well, I'm also just looking for the pressure, and there it is. Bugzy finally cleans up the kill. Spunkki here, he's looking to try and defend from the distance. He's 333 health. He will hit a fire spit, it looks like, and it doesn't actually connect. And PERDO from the back line, LAizy gets taken down as well. This could be the moment. They've all decided that it's time to strike, and the strike has occurred, and what a strike it was. Look, Thiel and SunCommander waiting patiently, and he's already off his horse. I love the pressure already given. A headshot on the way to the Ying as well, and that's what I need to see PERDO focusing on. But a nice headshot in the air on the Spunkki, and now that's his next target. He gets hit with almost a double tap, 758 health, but his nether step is available because he hit that reversal, which is beautiful.
Yeah, here, it took them so long to break that choke here. They are forced into do or die right now.
45 health.
Will go down there. District 69 looking strong right now. All five members still alive right now, but they need that healing totem from Grok to come up to top everyone off. They cannot afford to lose a single more fight, and they're just continuing to roll right now. Bugzy picks up Spunkki. LAizy going to follow the ship up. Bugzy with another kill on the Sun Commander. This is looking good for D69.
Bird's the only one left to contest, and that's not much of a contest indeed. It's 2-0 Burrito this time. D69 have actually taken the role of the early winners in this match. So they've got two more points to go. Things are working well for them. Nick, talk to me why things have changed.
Yeah, this is just a big, they flipped the kind of series meta on its head right now. They were allowed Burrito to get that heavy snowball comp two games in a row, and then they just go in with that kind of that standard, you know, the one heal, one tank, couple DPS, the well-rounded comp here, and District 69 just playing it better right now.
And PERDO, PERDO and Bugzy seem to be carrying the damage dealt and the ability for these
Bulldozer.
Yeah, Bulldozer being picked up. So we talked about this earlier on, and talk to me about Bulldozer and what he's going for.
So the reason he's picking this up is to destroy these Ying clones. He has not elected to go for the cauterize and just target focus out the targets of the Ying healing with that Bulldozer. Eevee's going to hit these clones so hard that they're getting one-shot.
One-shot.
Seeing that right there. The clone goes down in one shot. So that's kind of Bugsy's role almost right now with this Bulldozer to just keep the clones off the field.
See you later, clone. And that is a extremely literal sentence because those clones are being instantly deleted whenever Bugzy has a chance to shoot them. It is going to cause him there.
And Bugzy,
he's being so aware too. I love what Bugzy is doing because it's not just the clones are there. He's being aware that the clones are there, and that is what is so strong.
Gerrah on the high ground right now, pressuring out some commander, going to be able to pick him up. LAizy now feeling the heat as well. PERDO still on the high ground. Positional advantage very heavily in favor of District 69 right now.
Trying to get some mending spirits as well, but the Accursed Arm is straight on to the Smaldomba, actually, and so that is just going to be getting rid of the healer. Spunkki goes down as well. Bird, or Sun Commander, actually, is going to potentially be the last one to fall. The pressure is heavy on the side of D69. They haven't yet been able to do it. Seems like he stopped for
He confused himself there.
Maybe he figured out, wait a
second.
Master
of Illusions confuses himself every now and again.
He's like, I just moved right back into harm's way. Maybe I shouldn't have done that. I think he realized the error in his ways there before anyone else did. And D69, of course, help him out with taking him down early. The reversal comes down. He's trying to pick up LAizy. If he can, they can. Jera's there to back him up. And Thiel now, he's got pressure from both sides. Jera there with full health going in on the turtle. And he's going to get the double kill.
Burrito need to pump the brakes right now. I want to see them stabilize, get come back as five, do what they do right now. They're just letting District 69 keep these respawns staggered right now. I don't really like what I'm seeing right now. Spunkki is going to be picked off all by himself off to the side there once again.
It's PERDO. It's PERDO having his rhythm, feeling comfortable on the Androxus in an open map where he's not basically forced to deal with these tanks. If he doesn't want to, he can nether step away. You don't have the low ceilings. You have the open air. The king of the skies needs to breathe, Nick. This is what PERDO does. He's looking for another one. He gets another kill. He's looking for LAizy now on Maldomba. Is he going to be able to survive the wrath? PERDO, he's looking for it, but Bugsy's going to finish it off. The Accursed Arm will finish it on, and D69 will tie things up.
Damn.
3-2. 2-2.
2-2, boys. This is what we expected to see, though. This is the series that I was hoping for.
Beautiful.
With District 69 and Burrito going into this one.
Dude, this is a fantastic
showcase.
That was
showcase. Just, I mean, they got sort of the same comps going on. Two tank, two healer. Well, this is, okay, Burrito still kind of has that snowbally comp here.
Right.
All things told, but District 69 just doing better adjusting to it. They're picking up one tank, one healer, and it's more of Shipa on this Grok is kind of Elvin's pocket healer, keeping him alive there. PERDO Good sustain on Androxus. He does what he does well. Bugzy, good sustain on Eevee, definitely with that EU-style build. And gerrah can definitely fend for himself using that incitement and onslaught to keep himself mobile and well-sustained throughout.
Absolutely. It seems, excuse me, as I just readjust here, it seems like Bird and Thiel are in the position of tanking and being the support role that they love having supported, or at least the mentality of Burrito loves being supported by duo healers. So having, you know, LAizy in as the Maldamba, and of course SunCommander on the Ying, which they've been really loving throughout the entire set of matches today. But the key to, for me, looking at where everything went right for D69 and where everything went wrong for Burrito, is that Burrito had this patience, they had this awareness, and they had a little bit more tankiness where they had that Fernando instead of LAizy picking up the Maldamba. That draft wasn't ever going to be as tanky as if they had Fernando. And therefore, Ying was not going to be able to kind of hide out under the shields as much. And with the much more open space of this map that we just played on, it allowed Ying to be exposed, more so than has ever happened in I think, the earlier maps, especially because you have the lower corridors in the first map, even though it was
That's
on
right.
the temple side. It was just very low, so it wasn't able to really give a lot of, you know, the room for Ying was a little bit more to operate and get near the shields and stay safe. She
yeah.
was exposed.
I mean, taking a look at it, she's got 8 deaths this time around. Sun
yeah.
Commander really feeling the heat there, LAizy with 9 deaths. District 69 adjusting and doing a much better job of kind of taking out those healers there this time, and so the series is going to be all tied up 2-2.
I'm excited.
That's it.
I have no idea what's going to happen. Both teams have showed that they could do it. I really think it's going to come down to the right picks.
That's right. So we'll have to see what those drafts elect to be. We'll throw you guys over to the schedule right now. Like we mentioned, District 69, 2 points. Burrito, 2 points. It all comes down to this. These matches are best of 5. So the winner of this match will take that top spot. Well, District 69, if they win, won't take the top spot, but they will be poised to do so there because their next matchup is against Team Viral, and District 69 definitely favored in that matchup here. And we do have this final game available to it. It has all come down to this.
And on the side of Burrito, Thiel will be on the Fernando. LAizy on the Eevee, rocking the music there with that new weapon. Bird will be on Barrack, running that healing station build. And, of course, Sun Commander back onto the carry. He's now playing Cassie, taking that away from gerrah. And Spunkki, the famous, the loved Ying on the side of Burrito.
That's right. And for District 69, it will be PERDO on Androxus today. Shipa going to be on that pip for the first time today in this series. Love seeing that. eLvenpath going to take up arms as Makoa here. And rounding things out, it will be gerrah on Grok there. One more. Bugzy on his famous Drogos there. Very comfortable on this champion.
Very comfortable. See a lot of Havens prioritized, but a couple of Blast Shields. The tank's actually going for Blast Shields. So talk to me about this. Why is LAizy and Sun Commander going for Haven, whereas the tanks both decide we want to pick up Blast Shields here?
You need to be careful. These blasters do a lot of damage when they get those direct impacts. The tanks, the slower characters on the map here, those are the ones that are going to be looking to shred these shields, and then they can find those direct impacts. These
right.
are really good players on these slow-moving targets. Bugzy's going to be able to hit these rockets.
And there it is. Look at that. I mean, fantastic play by Bugzy. I mean, a direct rocket from that range is not easy to hit, anticipating where it was going and just taking down Sun Commander early. So it seems like he hasn't found his rhythm on Cassie yet. It's in a big choke. The Masterful is going to reset. He's going to be able to get that Masterful shot back again. The Fire Spit Explosion's almost up. He's going to have to get out of there. He's hitting his head on the ceiling. And it looks like that was a little bit too much for him. LAizy's going to get the double kill, take down gerrah and Shipa, and
Watch.
Get himself back onto the point with Sun Commander and Thiel to support him.
Yeah, Mr. Clutch right now being that man for his team. Gonna spot out PERDO, poke him out very low right now. Gonna, oh, he's gonna
nice
catch
reversal.
That one on the reversal there. Oh! But LAizy finding the shots right now, finding the picks, giving Burrito the room he needs to work right now. Start this push rolling.
You even know what's gonna happen. You saw what he was trying to do, and he said, I don't care if you know where I'm coming from. I'm gonna come a little bit faster, I'm gonna go a little bit harder, and that's all I'm gonna do, because that's what he needs as Eevee. He still loves the champion. He still loves the way that she plays.
Oh, beautiful
Her
block.
Speed is enough for him, because he's gonna blink in, blink out.
That was glorious.
And that's all he needs to do.
Yeah, that the reason that blink or that block was so good there, I saw it. I knew he wanted to press F and soar out of there, but he saw that Makoa out of the corner of his eye and was able to just block that hook there and then take off with the soar once he knew all the threats on the map were on cooldown there. Just continuing to land these shots, just continuous pressure coming out of LAizy right now.
Again, and he's being so much more aggressive than we saw Shipa be on this Eevee, right? And is it a result of maps? Why is this working so well for him right now?
LAizy's just really good at the character.
It's just LAizy.
This is his number two right now. Not able to find the Evo Mojo did come out from Shipa, though. They were not able to find a lot of follow-up there. LAizy finds the follow-up, though, sniping out this Vulpine right now. eLvenpath, the only one left alive. A little bit of a miss blink there just to get that bonus damage there. And LAizy finds another shot here. Burrito convert going up 2-0 very early.
Go in. Boy, that's what we needed. D69 have no answer for LAizy right now. It is absolutely nuts how well this man is playing off the walls, Michael Jackson style. LAizy is carrying this squad. But not only that, we see SunCommander finding his rhythm after that early death.
Everyone is streaking
right now. He is 4-1, and Bird and Thiel have been able to stay alive.
Yeah, so everyone's streaking right now on Burrito, but the reason we're praising LAizy at the moment is he is 6-0, so these are solo kills that he is finding to keep his streaks going. He's finding clutch picks, never letting District 69 get grouped up and get S5, but the Havens are starting to come out from them. Blast Shield 2 and Haven 2 is coming out from Burrito.
And Spunkki also on a 10 streak as well as the Ying, which again showcases that Perdo and squad were not able to deal with her, and that is that's always been the issue. So Perdo now finding some nice clutch shots onto Bird, and it looks like LAizy's almost going down. The Accursed Arm is available, and this is what's going to determine this fight.
Anyone.
He cannot find anyone with the dragon, and the Accursed Arm is wasted because he goes down. LAizy's still here. SunCommander, he's looking for more. However, Spunkki gets the kill onto Bugzy. And now it's looking like the turtle shield is going in, and everyone is just all over the place. But LAizy, he's the only one that has a direction. He's getting the kill. And Thiel picks up eLvenpath, and no one on D69 has a clue of what's going on.
Yeah, the capture very heavily in favor, moving up very quickly with all four members. Now 5 of Burrito on this capture point, 85. LAizy's going to move out to start dismounting people. It's going to be all. Here comes the zoning out with the Blizzard there. District 69 can't do anything to get in on this one.
Oh, but that's huge, though. If Jared's able to get on the point, he is going to contest with overtime. Thiel is there, and now with no LAizy, it looks like eLvenpath is going to go into the Ancient Rage. This could be big. Bird is there with Barrack, and he's set up. The Ying clones are keeping them nice and healthy. eLvenpath is still low, but will he be able to out-sustain? Shipa is there as well, but it does not look like that's enough. LAizy's back, and that spells trouble. Although Bugzy there, he's doing his best he can to fire onto this LAizy. The expectorate shot could come through. Masterful is not activated there.
No cooldowns there. Caught out. LAizy's going to be pinned to the wall.
But that was
6 feet under by PERDO. District 69 able to make the swing play when it counts right now. Now the ball is back in Burrito's favor here to try and get this one back, take back control of this zone right now. District 69, 84 points. Burrito need to make a move, and soon.
Absolutely, and it's 96 now. This is ever tight. It's 99-99. It's 2-2 in the set. This couldn't be a tighter experience. It's all up to this. Bird gets the kill onto Bugzy, and so that's going to take the dragon out of the fight for Burrito. Actually, D69. And Burrito are going to be in a great advantage without his area pressure. Gerrah is looking like he's going to be the next one to fall, and the Ying clones are up and lively, and that's going to be the capture for Burrito. It's 3-0 and D69 having a hard time with that one.
That's rough. That is a really, really good fight coming out from both teams. Burrito just able to eke that one out. That's got to be tacked up to they're able to win that first fight there, get the advantage so heavily in their favor early. All they needed was a small window there to close that capture out.
And it's just Bird is just so he's that win more character you spoke
the
about.
Aggro
he's
character.
Doing so well. He's drawing so much aggro. But
look
then
at this dwarf,
he
dude.
He stays alive long enough, and he's healing up with Healing Station. Look at how much his life is going up right now.
Bird against
healing
the world.
Station is so strong on Barrack, and if you're not running this card, you don't know what you're doing because he has just healed all the way back up to full during a full-time engagement.
Is this a Barrack or is this an Eevee right now? Bird just rolling out solo dolo right now, finding the poke, staying alive, getting good pressure on District 69 right now. Needs to take out this Grok here. Lockdown comes out at the final countdown here. Looking to close things out is Burrito.
But it doesn't do enough damage to force eLvenpath away. He's not too scared, but he should have been because he gets taken down. LAizy with a double kill.
Healing, man.
And that's going to be the end of the set.
Burrito.
Burrito, take it over D69, 3-2. What a game. What a set. What a play. The Barrack just was too strong, and LAizy back on his comfort pick of that Eevee. He shows us all how to do it.
And so Burrito able to close out the set here. This has huge implications down the line here. So we'll go ahead and take a look at this scoreboard right now just to see how things went down here. A lot of healing coming out of Ying, 72,000 into that 8-minute game here. Obviously, this does include that draft selections time, so that is a very, very, very good time made by Burrito here. Just able to do such good work here with this snowball comp today.
It was something that D69, I think, had an opinion about. And basically, when they were able to, you know, address that opinion and say, you know what, this wasn't working, it was almost a little bit too late. They got themselves caught back into the game and had a very even fight from then on, but they went for the gamble and it didn't pay off. Sometimes that's why you're the best team. And sometimes that's why the best team doesn't always win if they try new things. I at least like that they were, you know, confident enough to say, we're going to go with our strategy, you go with yours. We're going to counter that. We're not just kind of try and do it better.
For sure. So Burrito definitely showing their dominance here today. They will be taking that over there. The map's going to be brought up for you just a second, showing just how things went down. This was the bloodbath we expected to see coming out of these two EU heavyweights right now. District 69 taking the first one. Burrito answering back twice in a row, but District 69 answering back in game number four there, taking the 4-0 sweep there, and Burrito finally closing things out in a dominant fashion here. That will be the closing note for this series here. We are going to throw you guys to a quick break while we get the next series loaded up for you. One thing we do need to make an announcement on, Paladins will be doing a server restart at 4:30, so rather than get the series interrupted during that, we're going to just use our break screen here to kind of get you guys through that server restart. So it may be a little bit longer than normal, but we want to get you the action and just keep it uninterrupted. We think that's very important here for your spectating pleasure.
Absolutely. So stay tuned with us. We'll make sure to let you know when we're coming back on. And in the meantime, make sure to enter into the giveaway. You could do !! giveaway in Twitch chat, and then YouTube will post that every now and then. And it's also in the description to be able to win a Founders Pack or potentially 800 crystals. And when you yourself are going out trying those hot EV strats there, that's right. LAizy showed us all.
See you guys just a sec.